Welcome to ARVN, Amateur Radio Video News. The program you're about to see is free to watch, courtesy of YouTube. Thanks, YouTube. But it wasn't free to make. ARVN's got a lot of money invested in video equipment like this sweet camera and that editing system back there. And it takes a lot of time to shoot and edit a program like this. So I'm asking you to make a voluntary payment, contribution, whatever you want to call it. Just stop by our website, arvn.tv, and you'll see a link to make that payment, whatever you think the program is worth to you. I guess you could say that this program is brought to you by you. So thanks for watching and enjoy the show.
I'm just going to give you a summary of the state of the art of APRS. And the number one thing that I always start with by saying, APRS was never ever designed to be a vehicle tracking system. It was always designed to be, if you go back to 1980s, when we were doing packet. In fact, if you go back to the very beginning of packet, we were sitting there in our basements doing our ham radio projects, and you know, we had this dumb terminal, and every now and then you'd see a beacon coming from somebody else that was in their shack doing something, and he would be beaconing what he was doing. And I thought this was really neat, because you could just watch this dumb terminal, and whenever anybody in the original AMRAD organization, which you know developed the AX25 protocol, or at least made it legal in the United States, helped make it legal in the United States, was doing something, you'd see it on this little beacon. Well, then what's the first thing we attach to an AX25 packet link is a BBS. Why not? Okay, so now all of a sudden, you've got this dumb screen there that's now starting to scroll this guy reading his mail all the time. And as soon as you start seeing that, all the live users went away because it's pretty boring watching somebody else read their email. And of course, because you had a BBS, there was no reason to have a live contact, because you can just post your message and then read it later. And to me, amateur radio was always about communicating with the other guys. It was not about this computer stuff. So, very first thing from day one, I wrote a little software that would just ignore all the BBS tracking and only capture the beacons. Who was on this channel and what were they doing? I wasn't interested with all the BBS traffic. So that really was what APRS evolved from the 1980s. And back then we wanted to do, in the AMRAD organization, we wanted to do this 100-mile endurance run, horses and humans running through West Virginia or over in Virginia for 24 hours. And the AMRAD organization, we always volunteered to provide some tracking services. So it came up back then, it was the VIC-20 and the Commodore 64 were the only computers we had. And so we hooked them up to our TNCs and realized that instead of having a connection protocol, we would just transmit our information and everybody would capture it. And so their screen would show, you know, the latest information from each of the checkpoints. And so I call that the Connectionless Emergency Traffic System, or SETS. And we demonstrated it again in the late 1980s at the National Disaster Medical Exercise, a FEMA exercise here in Washington, D.C., where now we'd moved up to Commodore 64s, and the same thing is primarily it was used for transmitting triage tags, you know, the tag on your toe that says what's wrong with you, and where you need. There was about five numbers on that tag, and that was fantastic because it didn't take but a minute to type in those five numbers. That packet went out, it was grabbed by every Commodore 64, and now everybody at all the checkpoints knew where all of those people were. Then the AT computer, you know, the PC-AT, IBM computer came out, and I finally realized I needed to move over to that platform. And right about in that time frame, I realized I could call it the automatic packet reporting system and match my call sign. And I remember I couldn't even sleep that night when I realized, wow, I finally got some phonetics for my call sign. And so that was about in the 1992 time frame, and so that's when I had a paper at the original or the Digital Communications Conference in 1992, in Teaneck, New Jersey, where I said this is what I'm calling APRS, and back then there were no maps, there was no Google Earth, there was no anything. Every map system other than the Is it the Tiger database of the National,
Census Bureau.
Census Bureau, okay. Which was derived from, what's the organization out here in
DRO or DEMA? National Geospatial Agency?
Yeah, a national...
National
no, it's not those guys. Oh, boy.
USGS.
US Geological Survey. There you could download, they would send you a CD, but you could download, point by point vector data for all the maps. So initially, though, all of the original APRS maps for all 50 states and the United States and the world were done by me with a pencil and writing down the coordinates of every point, around the Horn of Africa, every, thing. It's done. I did that for years. In the evenings, I would just sit there, with the kids, and I'd just be writing down points, entering those points into a thing, and that was building a map. So that's why the original APRS DOS maps were pretty crude. But I was never interested in the map for its accuracy. I was interested in the map as just to give a spatial background of where the network was. Where are the ham radio operators, and how can I connect to them, and so how can we communicate? It was never about trying to see, are you in your driveway? Well, then, but of course, that was the number one frustration. People wanted better maps. And so that's when the Sproul brothers came in with Mac APRS and Win APRS. And I'm doing all this in BASIC, okay? And so I had 30,000 lines of code written in BASIC, which did the original APRS. And I was using the maps from the USGS, but the most I could generate was about a 3,000 point map before I'd used up all the memory available to DOS. And so my maps had to swap in and out in real time. I thought it was pretty good for, I don't know anything about mapping, but I just made it so you could zoom and additional maps would come in and so forth. And the one thing I did like about it, though, is you could make any map you wanted to. I hooked it up to a mouse to where you could just sit down and draw a map on your screen, and that was the map for your event. And the original concept of APRS back then was we didn't have GPSs were $1,000 a pop. And so the initial ones we were tied into LORAN, if you could find a LORAN system. And the whole idea about the maps was simply that you just draw a very crude, every public service event you do in ham radio, you get the little map that somebody's put together. And it didn't have to be geographically correct because hardly anybody had, LORAN or GPS. The whole idea was every APRS operator at the event is looking at the same map, and when you hear that the water wagon is at checkpoint 13, somebody puts a click there and says, the water wagon's at checkpoint 13. Everybody else sees that. So my concept of APRS was tactical situational awareness so that everybody can see what the EOC, the Emergency Operations Center or Headquarters Center, sees. And so the whole concept was about putting information onto the system. And again, that was completely lost because once GPSs came out, everybody thought, if we want to see something on APRS, we've got to have a GPS attached to it. So they're putting GPSs on dogs, on water wagons, on, just everything. And still, you're only going to get 5% of the assets that you want to track covered by putting some device on it. The batteries are going to dead. It's going to rain. It's going to fall in the mud and everything else. That was never what APRS was about. APRS was about what do the humans who are looking at the tactical situation, what are they dealing with? And if they just make sure that their screen is updated with all their knowledge, everybody else, who's on a different voice net, or a different voice net, if every one of them is just putting all the information that they're aware of on their map, and everybody's seeing the same tactical map, then everybody's updated in real time. But with the cheap availability of GPS, and then the people started building the trackers, it's very easy to transmit an AX25 packet. Just write the software, transmit. Receiving is a little bit harder. And so we started getting all of these, what they're called APRS trackers. And that's very frustrating to me because that further removes the human from communications. And so you see this guy driving around on the road, you can't talk to him, you can't communicate with him, you can't send him a message. It was very frustrating that the whole purpose of APRS was lost. The other thing which I hadn't mentioned very much was the local information. If everybody sitting in their basements, whatever they're doing, or whatever they're working on, or they're talking on the net, or whatever, if they would just send a single beacon out, the APRS software is supposed to just capture that beacon, and now we can see what's going on in the local area. So APRS has two net cycle times. That comes from Navy terminology. And that is, if you are doing something local, and it's only within your local area, your VHF one repeater range, I want your beacon every 10 minutes, what's going on, so that the idea is if you turn on your radio on APRS and you monitor for 10 minutes, you should be able to know everything that's going on in your local area. Meetings in progress, nets going on, satellites in view, traffic in the local area, just everything going on in ham radio or that can be delivered to you by ham radio. If you're interested, what's kind of going on in the region, like Northern Virginia or in Maryland or whatever, watch for 30 minutes, and everything that is beaconing out its information more than one hop should beacon only once every 30 minutes. That's to keep the load on the network down, and things that are further and further away are usually of less and less interest to you, and so they don't need to be refreshed that much. So there are a lot of people saying, Well, of course, the network grew to where it was just totally saturated and was quite unreliable because of all the packets being transmitted. And that's when we realized that, a lot of people said, what good is it? You're just beaconing the same information over and over and over. Yes?
Can you talk about the process of how it got to 144.39? Because when you talk about, there's uses of it that weren't in the original idea, why don't you just move to a different frequency?
Okay, I'll get to that one. Where was I? I'll go ahead and answer that one. Originally, we chose 140.579, which was right up at the very end. You remember, in that time frame of huge packet growth, we had 145.01, 03, 05, 07, 09. 140, and then 145.515.357.596.163. We had 30 different packet frequencies, and I dare you. I don't know what's out there now, but you'd probably be only be able to find one or two BBSs still on the air. So anyhow, we went to the very top channel, and we said, okay, we'll take 145.79. That was about the time then that we, the manned space was going to go up on the space shuttle, and so we needed to have a space frequency 145.800. And so we wanted to I had a foot in both camps, and so we wanted to accommodate that. And I said, we'll move if you'll give us another frequency and then forever hold your peace. And so they gave us 144.39, and that's why we're down there in the weak signal part of the band, because it should have made a lot of other people happy by clearing out the space frequency. And Steve Dempsey, I let him, there was going to be a lot of slings and arrows, okay? And I didn't want to, I was pushing a lot of other things, and I didn't want to be out at the front. And Steve Dempsey was out at the front and said, okay, so Steve Dempsey gets the credit for being the public face of that move. But from the background, I was all for it from day one. I just didn't want to be pushing it, be the one that was pushing it so hard. So anyway, we pulled that off. But anyway, that's the bottom line. Slide one. We got 100 slides to go. Let's see. So when I think of APRS, it has nothing to do with vehicle tracking, which is a transmitting function. It has to do with when I get in my car and turn on my radio, what is APRS going to provide for me? And I agree with every single person that raises his hand and says, well, why in the world do I want APRS? I'm just transmitting my position. And I agree 100% with him. I don't care where he is, and nobody else cares where he is, except maybe his wife or his girlfriend. And so APRS was never about transmitting. It was about human-to-human communications, because in ham radio, we're spread over 6,000 channels. We have no way to communicate to the other guy. You see a guy driving by with all kinds of antennas on his roof. You can't talk to him because you can't figure out what frequency he's on. You can try 5.2. Sometimes that works. Now, one of the things that, since it was always about human-to-human information exchange and human contact, one of the first things we did back in the year 2000, I said, I want to have APRS touch tone. I want to be able to communicate with the other 95% of ham radio that does not do APRS, and yet everybody has a touch tone HT. And what is APRS? The most important thing about APRS is when you get in your car, you transmit a packet, and instantly, the whole world knows that you have just now turned on your radio. You are available for ham radio communications. And all it took was one transmission to do that. In APRS, that's a packet that contains your position. But why not have built into everybody has a a DTMF radio. Let me come back here and find my radio. And so since the year 2000, I said everybody ought to be able to do that. And so here is a, now this happens to be a D7 radio, but just say you have just any old radio, and you program your call sign, you know, using the keypad into DTMF, and if you, okay, when I get in my car, if I just did that instantly, if the repeater heard that, it knows my call sign. It knows my position. How does it know my position? Because it heard it on the input of that repeater. I've got to be within 10 miles of that repeater. And remember, APRS is a global network now. And so, and we're all interconnected by VoIP and text messaging and everything else. So narrowing down on the entire planet where you are to the nearest 10 miles is a significant accomplishment. Okay, so I got the call sign. I know your call sign. I know the time that you turned on your radio. I know where you are approximately on the earth. I know what frequency you were on, because the device that heard that knows what frequency it heard it on. I know what's going on at that. Was that a club repeater? Is that a laptop sitting in this room that's listening to everybody in this room? You know, the thing that receives those tones then adds these other 12 layers of what's going on in real time to your call sign, injects that into the APRS, and that's 95% of what APRS ever was about. It was having somebody be able to check in, its presence. APRS, I like to say, provides amateur radio presence. It lets you know who's on the air. Okay, I've been talking this for 10 years, 11 years now, and we've had three or four people start the implementation. I built an original one, ran in BASIC, used a hardware external decoder, never intended anybody else to copy it. I just wanted, because I assumed that as soon as I demonstrated it, it would take off like wildfire, because now everybody in ham radio could join this global network of being present. And but anyhow, none of those have really gotten out into the mainstream. I think we're right on the cusp now, after 10 years of talking about this, that it might happen. Next thing I'm going to talk about is text messaging. When ham radio first came out, in fact, it was at Dayton, five, 6 years ago now. TAPR ARRL had a special session at Dayton. And the topic was, what are we going to do about the future of ham radio? You know, everybody's over 50, it's dying, and so forth. Of course, they've been saying that since I was a kid. And I'm now over 60, and it's the same thing. Nothing's changed. Deal with it. You know, we still got just as many hams. And so I'm out there just like everybody else, promote, you know, Boy Scouts, I go out for this the jamboree on the air and everything else. And you know, we're all out there proselytizing to the kids. But what I say, that's why you're there. But what you're reeling in are the parents. Because the parents are the ones that are going to get involved, because they're over 50. And that's going to continue amateur radio. And that's exactly what's happened. So, when, 100% go for the youth. But don't forget that you're reeling in the parents. They're the ones that have the money, the resources, the time, and the interest. Okay. I talked about this one yesterday, so most of you heard it, and I got tired of packet radio getting no respect at field day. Been beating my head against that wall for 20 years. And so now we finally said, okay, we're going to do our own thing the third week in July every year and just see what kind of networks we can build overnight. A year ago, 2 years ago now at Dayton, we said, wait a minute, RFID. I've been wanting to do RFID for APRs for years and years and years. And the problem was, how do you put a detector on that door so that everybody that enters the room here, if they have their APRS, their RFID in their wallet, and, you know, we can transmit that out to the club and everybody can see who's at the club house tonight. And we never could solve that that antenna problem around the door. Or the ones that had that kind of 6 foot range, now the tag was was more expensive than the $2 RFID tag. And I'll talk about all these later. Let's get going. Here's the text messaging problem. And that is, there are 26 systems that I counted in ham radio that currently do text messaging. And only the ones in the upper left hand corner can communicate with each other within APRS text messaging. And so And that's part of the topic of tomorrow. Let's tie all these systems together. And we are slowly doing that. A lot of these now you could cross-connect through the internet to APRS and so forth. But the funny thing, oh, I know the story I was going to say. I was starting off on to a few minutes ago. And that was ARRL TAPR at Dayton. I didn't finish that story, so here it is. They had this special session. And they said, why in the world, you know, we're stagnant. We're not going anywhere. Look at cell phone technology now. Every kid now has a cell phone, and he's texting like crazy. And in ham radio, we don't have anything like that. And I stood up on my chair in the back of the room. I says, you guys have got to be kidding me. We've had this HT for, back then, it was 10 years, almost 10 years, so 8 years from 80. So that would have been 2006. I said, we've had this this radio for 8 years that can do text messaging globally by call sign alone. Just know the guy's call sign, enter a text message, and you can text. We've had that for 8 years, and you old FUDs just won't try it out. And look where texting is, and tweeting, and everything else. Ham radio's been doing that, since CW, but we've had it in APRS all this time, and yet still only 5% of ham radio operators are ever even going to try APRS. And of those 5% that even try APRS, less than 1% of them are ever going to send a text message, because they're over 50, and they say, you've got to be kidding me. I'm never going to communicate by this keypad. That's what they were saying when Kenwood first came out with this. I'm never going to send a message by this keypad. And, of course, the whole world has bypassed them, and the whole world is sending text messages by keypad, and we still got the ham radio operators in. We need a new special way to communicate. Okay. Yaesu has now joined the ranks. Yaesu, a year or so ago, came out with the FTM350R, latest and greatest APRS technology. And the one thing they've added, which we wanted very much, was, to communicate. Remember, this is all about finding other hams to communicate with. And to do that, you got to know if you're going to be using VHF. If it's HF, you don't care, you know, no matter where they are on the planet, if you hear them, you can work them. With VHF, it's not that way. You got to know that they're close enough to be able to communicate by VHF. Well, so APRS was always about your location. So you can see on the map the network, who you can communicate to and how. Number two in that information, not only your latitude and longitude, but also your antenna height. We call it PHG, power, height, and gain of your station. Because when you look at a map and you just see two people, you can't tell if they can communicate. You got to know how high this guy is and how high this guy is so that your software can tell you whether they're within range of each other. And so that was fundamental to APRS. The problem was the most popular APRS program written is called UIView, and 85% of all the users use that, and it did not implement power, height, gain. So you see these little icons on the map, and you don't know if they have a 150-mile range because they're on a 10,000-foot mountain in Wyoming, or where they have a 1-mile range because they're an HT in somebody's basement. It was just floored me. I never could get that author to change that because he said, well, everybody knows that radio ranges aren't perfect circles. And I say, that's true. Everybody knows that. So when we draw a circle, we're just simply saying that this guy's circle is bigger than this guy's circle. Okay. And you use your own knowledge of the local terrain as to whether you think, well, it's going to be better in this direction than this direction because he's on the side of a hill. That's what the ham radio operator already knows. But I want to know the difference between the guy with a 1-mile circle and the guy with a 100-mile circle is 10,000 to 1 coverage. And yet UIView, which 85% of APRS operators were using, completely blind to that. So we lost almost a decade because all we had was trackers out there that you couldn't talk to. You couldn't text to them. So nobody learned how to text message, which was in to APRS from the beginning. And now you didn't have any information on their communications range. A few years ago, we realized the next important parameter besides where they are and how high their antenna is what frequency they're on. never even occurred to us in the beginning because APRS was always on one frequency and it was all about digital communications. Well, now, as I see these mobiles driving around, I realize every single one of them has another voice radio in the vehicle. So what's the frequency he's on? How can I talk to him? So in the latest round of radios from both Kenwood and Yaesu, we've added an additional 10 characters onto the station display list so you can see what frequency his radio is on. And it's automatically done by these new radios. So now I can see what frequency the guy's on. And it also shows me what tone he's operating on in his shift and everything else. For example, for setting up this radio, you set up that you want your beacon to include your frequency, or your frequency and your squelch and your shift. You know, you indicate what information you want to have in your beacon. It's still amazing to me that I still see APRS people driving around with these radios, that's their number one new feature in APRS this decade, and more than half of them haven't figured out the menu to turn it on. So, I see enough D710s also, right, that way. And then the Kenwood, remember the D7HT, this thing's been out since 98, right? What is that now, 14 years old, 13 years old? Most popular radio ever. And so now they finally reproduced it. Fantastic radio, and it also includes your transmit frequency. Oh, now once you include transmit frequency, you'll notice then that there's a button down here on each of these radios that says QSY. When you see somebody in the station list, you select them, and if they have a frequency over here, you push tune, and boom, you've instantly shifted to his frequency in PL. I don't know about you guys, but you know, every radio has PL. Every repeater now has PL. Why? Because it's just there. So why not use it? The only problem is we've forgotten about the guy driving through the area, scanning around. He finds a conversation, and he can't figure out for beans how to get into it. And he said, well, turn on your scanning, your PL scanning. Yes, but I'm surprised how many radios still don't even have that. And then throw in that the number of repeaters that don't put the PL on the output, so even if you're scanning, you can't figure out what the PL is. It's just crazy. We are building roadblocks to the ability to communicate, and yet APRS is always intended to be the solution. Every device that comes out now, everybody has a wireless device of some kind, and here, Jack, KG4GJY, wrote an application for this as the one laptop per child, you know, the $100 laptop, because it has tremendous Wi-Fi capability, and so here you can open up this little window down in the corner, and there's the text message window, and so you can be sending and receiving texts from all over the world and stay informed with people. Now, no longer do you have to write any APRS application, because if you've got wireless, you go to APRS.fi, and you can see the world. And you can zoom in to right where you are and see everybody around you, and that's already been done. So the only thing that you really need to add APRS application to just about anything these days is just add a little bit of message capability. I talked about that yesterday. Again, to have an event that we could call our own, there are 50,000 miles of linear trails in the country, primarily the Appalachian Trail, the Pacific Crest Trail, and the Continental Divide Trail, and then there's the National, there's another word in there, trail, which is the Lewis and Clark Trail. And then you add in all the abandoned railroads, and you've got 50,000 miles of trails. And I say, let's get out there. And APRS works fantastic in a long linear line, because then you can send really long packets because they don't collide with each other. APRS is not very good when you go more than two hops in any direction, because then you're just saturating a huge area. But in a linear trail, it's just one copy going right down the trail. A lot of fun. And using Google Earth for planning events is just fantastic. You can zoom right in onto the top of the mountain, stick a pin in it, stick a pin in the other mountain you want to talk to, tell it to draw a line between it and connect that to the ground, and you can see the profile. And you can zoom all the way in and choose the picnic table you're going to sit at, or choose the rock that you're going to sit on, or choose the tree that you're going to put your antenna up in. It's just unbelievable. This is a free software downloadable, KX40, John Huggins. I found this online, and you just enter the lat long of the two end coordinates, what link margin you want, and it'll tell you the performance of that. So we developed this for every one of those paths. And of course, now Google Earth would tell you that this path can't possibly work because it goes right through the Earth. But this is only a 104-kilometer path, and so they're close enough that you get knife edge refraction over these two, and you still get a 12 dB signal margin for that path. So just, yeah.
Sorry, real quick. For those who want to know more about this, the program it does have is actually called Radio Mobile.
Radio Mobile, thank you.
And if you're taking notes on that, don't look for Radio Link, look for Radio Mobile. Oh. It's an incredibly powerful program for all kinds of link analysis and coverage analysis.
Wow.
Oh, okay, so Radio Link, okay, that's not something I did, that's where it comes, yeah. So it's Radio Mobile.
It's called Radio Mobile, and I can't remember, it's a Canadian ham that does that for sure. That's it.
By the way, I assume everybody in here knows about APRS.fi. Is there anybody that does not know what APRS.fi is? Okay, because it used to be, you know, you're trying to tell people what APRS is about. Now you just say is go to APRS.fi. That's all you got to tell them. Because when they bring that up, the internet kind of figures out, well, looks like you're coming into the internet somehow in Maryland, and it'll go ahead and draw you a map right there in Maryland. So instantly you get the map, you zoom in, you get to see where everybody and all of APRS is available to you. Now, here is an example of taking it to the next level, because on 144.39, well, I left out the history that back in the beginning, we figured it was 8 hops from here to Georgia, and so or 7 hops. We wanted to get from here to Georgia, Atlanta, and 7 hops, you know, digipeters along the Appalachian Trail. And we were almost doing that because there weren't that many people on APRS. But APRS exploded, and so now you're lucky to get 2 hops because there's so many collision that, you know, the chances that you're going to get 3 hops are infinitesimally small, and now adds more. So, but about this time, people started providing the internet gateways, and so now doing it by RF was not quite as interesting. But anyhow, what we realized is the only way we can keep the network from saturating is tell everybody to cut your information back to only your nearest neighborhood, because APRS was never about anything more than local. We use the internet to look in, to be voyeurs, to see what's going on in a certain area. There's a special event going on in Dayton. You want to be able to zoom in on APRS and see what's going on in Dayton. But again, you're just looking over the shoulder of the locals. The intent of the APRS network is to serve the locals. So now everybody has cut back. They're only transmitting 2 hops out in all directions. And that pretty well, for example, will cover central Maryland. You can see everybody in central Maryland, and you can't talk to anybody beyond that, so you don't really need to go much further. But here is the hike across Maryland. It's once a year. It goes the 40 miles along the Appalachian Trail from one end, from Pennsylvania to Virginia. And hams have always provided communication support for this by setting up a ham at each kind of checkpoint along the way and being interested or providing communications in case any emergencies crop up. And then there's a couple of chase walkers that actually hike along with HTs, and we know where they are. So their approach, and almost every other club in the country, and every article you see about APRS says, okay, well, then we're going to put GPS units on a couple of these people, and we're going to track them. And the net result is you sit out in headquarters, and you know where the first guy is because somebody, well, the idea of the original APRS is a couple of people with their laptops, and whenever they hear the lead runner just cross this point, the guy just clicks on where the runner was before, moves it to there, hits enter, and since the lead runner of a marathon runs at 9 knots, you give him a speed of 9 knots, and the original APRS DOS always dead reckoned all objects, so any object that you put on a map that was moving would continue to move. So you didn't need to transmit frequency updates. And so you'd see this lead runner moving down the trail, and you'd get a report in from Burksville that the lead runner had just passed that point, and okay, you were off by 500 yards. So you just, this dead reckoning object. So you click it, put it back to where it was there, and now the dead reckoning continues. And that was the concept of APRS, is human operators managing the information so that everybody got the right picture. Okay, so this last year, they got to where 2 people in the club now had APRS radios with GPS. You know, the latest APRS, the D772, now has the GPS built into it. So it's all in one, no wire, no extra wires, no nothing. Just turn it on, we see you, and away you go. So I said, well, that's great, but what about the other 150 runners on the trail? And I said, do you guys, you know, keep track of those runners? No, we don't even track them. I mean, well, but you keep a list of where these 150 runners are along the trail so that their loved ones can say, well, you know, nobody's heard from my dad yet, and he's runner number 120. Where's number 120? Oh, we don't know. We're just hands. Well, that's what APRS was about from day one. So for this event, when I was going to come along, and it turns out both of my kids were home from college, I said, we're going to do it the way I want to do it. Myself and my two kids, we're going to do it the way we want to do it, and we're going to participate. I'm going to be down here at the end point. I'm going to drop my son off here. He was only going to be there for 2 hours, then he had to go do something. So I said, rather than going the hiking along with the runners, I'm going to put you at a checkpoint going the opposite direction. And when you go from here to there, you're going to pass all 150 runners, and I want you to take your HT. Now, he's a kid, right? Text messaging, no sweat. So he's walking down the trail at a very good clip, and whenever he passes a runner, he enters in the runner's number and hits send. He sends an APRS message that has the runner number in it. Okay. By the time he got to the next checkpoint, I had a database of all 150 runners that he had passed during that one section, and what time they passed him within a minute or two. And not only did I have it, but everybody else with an APRS radio in the entire county had that information on their receiver, on their radio, in the message list. The other thing is my son had never seen the THD-72 before, had never sent a message before, and I did get to spend about a half hour with him between his video game teaching him how to use it. The next morning is when my daughter had come home. She learned how to operate the THD-72 while she was eating her cornflakes in 10 minutes. That's the only time I saw her, because then she was out the door and was supposed to go up, and her walk was supposed to start up here. In 10 minutes, I give a kid a radio and say, send me information on every runner you pass, and there it is. It just starts showing up. They did it. I've been talking for 18 years, and there are some hams that still can't figure out how to operate their radio. Yeah.
I was wondering if there's any flexibility with APRS software to interchange GPS that long versus your radio maidenhead. A big portion of the APRS users are stationary. I don't know what your thoughts are on that.
They're not stationary, but they also don't know their maidenhead grid square either. Are stationary.
Not the runners, but for instance, like a big portion of the network is repeaters or someone's house.
Right.
Has there been any thought about interchanging that?
You can send maidenhead coordinates to spec, for sure.
And that would put you on a map?
Oh, yeah. APRS DOS, APRS from day one had grid squares, both four-digit and six-digit, and we went ahead for the full eight-digit. So you could do a maidenhead position. But how does everybody look up their maidenhead position anymore? They use a GPS, and it tells them what it is. So if you got the GPS, you might as well enter it.
I mean, you don't need a GPS to position in your house.
No, you just look at a map. And you don't need coordinates. You just look at a map and say, I'm there. You move the cursor to there and hit enter, and you're on the map, and you're on everybody else's map. And so that was the thing about objects, where people would say, well, I'm not going to look up Win APRS and Mac APRS. Initially, they said, well, enter the coordinates for this object. No, just move the cursor there and hit enter. Okay? And you say, well, that map might not be perfect. Doesn't matter. Everybody else is using the same map. If you put it where you visualize it should be on this map, even if it's a hand-drawn map, everybody else will see it on the same copy of the same hand-drawn map. We've gotten away from that now because everybody has maps that are perfect, all the way down to a couple of feet. So we don't need that kind of stuff. But two things that we did at this event that were new. Number one, I showed how. Now, you can't do it at the beginning of the race, when 15 people pass you in 10 seconds, okay? But nobody's fallen down on the rocks by then. But after about an hour of this, 6-hour event, they're spread out enough to where they kind of come by in twos and threes and fours and fives. And so you could kind of enter those. And all it is you just enter a time. The message that my son was entering was he would enter the time. And then for the next few minutes, he would just enter the three-digit number of every runner, comma, that he passed. And then when he kind of filled up his screen, he'd hit send. So I would get a message that came in that said, at 10:13, these 10 runners my son saw. Now, that doesn't mean he saw them all at 10:13, but at 10:13, I got a report of the last 10 runners that had kind of passed by where he was located. So anyway, but again, the beauty of that was it was very easy to enter, and once entered, everybody had a copy of it. If they just knew to go look in their radio, if they wanted to see where is number 113, they could just go through those list of numbers, find out where it was, see when he was seen and where. Okay, so, but of course I would never get another, see they were my kids, they had to do it my way. I said, do this. And they were happy to do it because they'd been hearing about APRS all their life, and so here I got to force them out to do it. But I would never be able to, I think, convince club that, although a couple of people are now realizing, yeah, we could be doing that, and we would actually then be able to know where these runners are. The number two thing we did is look at this map. You see this big red circle here? This is the existing Digipeter out here in Hagerstown, I believe. That's the existing Digipeter. Covers this this area fantastic. Remember, this is the Appalachian Trail. So it's coming in broadside, so you've got dead solid coverage all along the Appalachian Trail. Over here on the Frederick Mountains, you've got a standard Digipeter, this red circle here, that's hitting it from this side. You've got solid coverage for APRS. And so the club was going to then have their one or two hikers that did have APRS be able to be tracked. The blue dots is their performance. There was almost an hour and a half here where we didn't see that guy. And I said, the problem is, it's not that you don't have APRS coverage, it's that both of those Digipeters are also hearing every other packet in the state of Maryland, Georgia, Pennsylvania, and Delaware. So the problem with APRS is not necessarily the sensitivity of the Digipeters, but getting them to hear what you want them to hear and not everything else. So I said, let's do the simple thing, page up, of we're going to put a Digipeter right here on the same mountain where there's already an APRS thing, and it's just going to be a temporary thing. A guy just drives up there, parks his D700 mobile APRS radio, parks on that hill, and he just simply takes his normal APRS frequency and then shifts it up 600 and sets a minus 600 offset. So now this Digipeter, and now we tell the hikers along this trail, just instead of operating on 144.39 simplex, operate on 144.39 plus 600. What do we got? The hikers are listening to every packet in the planet. They can hear, they can see anybody driving by, they can see everybody that's on. Everybody in the whole event is listening on 39. The whole event is operating on 144.39 as far as information coming in. But if you want to be heard, you transmit on 144.99, and this temporary mobile sitting over here on this mountain is going to hear you. There's nothing else on there. The only things coming in on 144.99 are packets from these four or five HTs and the other participants. Now look at the performance difference, and you see these red ones are all the packets heard with the plus 600 offset. We've been saying this for years and years and years, that if you're going to do a special event, it's a good idea to use 144.39 because the network is already there for long distances and so forth. But if you really want a lot of high density use, still keep it on 144.39 so that everybody in the area can see what's going on. But just shift your input up to plus 600 so that it's not competing with the other 9,999 packets that are on the frequency. Yeah?
Did you just feed back out for 144.99?
No.
Did you just feed it back out for that?
Yeah. So again, as a ham, you need to be aware. If my son is right there, and you know, and I got to go rescue him or something, and he's not getting into this Digipeter, I've got to know that. Well, his thing's still beaconing, but it's transmitting on 99. If I want to hear him six simplex, I've got to go, you know, shift. I got to hit the reverse button to be able to hear those packets direct. So again, this shows you that when you eliminate the collision effect, APRS can be very, very reliable. So that was the lesson there. Now here's my son's messages. At 13:13, You know, within a couple of minutes of there, these are all the runners that he passed by. And again, remember, I didn't have to do anything to make this slide, because when I got home the next day, I got around to it. I just, you know, went to aprs.fi, or in this case, it was aprs.findyou. I said, show me all the messages from Hiker 2. Boom. That's the other advantage of being on 14439, is every packet on the planet is archived forever. And so you can always go, you can do anything on 14439, and you say, gosh, it sure would have been neat if we had kept track of that. Just go to findyou.com or aprs.fi, and the history goes back forever, and you can go back and see everything that happened. And so sure enough, if you count all those numbers up, he reported every runner and every ham. And the hams, like I said, had never even tracked the runners by hand. And here, everybody had a copy in their own radio. I don't know if they'll do it again, but we can do this. Now, what is APRS? It is not... That's that. It is not... That's a half hour. Wow. It is not maps. Show me where the ham radio is on that map. This disgusted me. This kind of approach to APRS disgusted me. Yeah, I've got a map, and somewhere I got some ham. I can't see what their communication... Nothing. This is more like what APRS is, and what does the network look like? How close are people together, and so forth? A lot of other stuff, and you know how they all communicate. Everything digipetes off of everything else if you want it to. But in 1997, the Sproul brothers with Mac APRS and Win APRS and Steve Dempsey with K4HG tied it into the internet, and the rest is history. And that is, everybody within range of a digipeter or whatever communicates on APRS on RF. But if there should be an iGate in the area, and every packet heard goes into the internet. Everywhere in the world, it all goes in. Nothing comes back out. It just all goes in there. Now, what this did was generate a generation of couch potatoes, or shack potatoes, as I like to call them. Because now, you can voyeur on everything going on in ham radio and never even leave your shack. You just go to aprs.fi and you can see it. But of course, the benefit for this is that every one of these iGates also knows who is in proximity to it, who it has heard on its RF port. And so, if this guy over here sends a message to W3XYZ, like every other packet that goes in, if there is an iGate anywhere on the planet that says, oh, I've heard W3XYZ locally on my RF port, I'll take that message out and send it out to RF. Now, these are not emails. This is live messages. It's delivered within a fraction of a second. If the guy's there, his radio sends back an ACK and it comes back to the originator. If the guy's not there, it retries a couple of times, and after a while it gives up. APRS is about live communications. It's not storing forward. This was the original DOS map, and this is showing you the power height gain circles. You see the green stars are the repeaters in the area. Some repeaters have a lot more coverage than others, so it's ridiculous when you see that repeater on the map and you say, hey, that's a pretty good repeater. No, it's practically useless compared to this one over here on the edge of the beltway. And of course, each home station, his circle and the mobiles show up with what their communications raise. As long as these two circles intersect, those two should be able to communicate with each other. But it was all about seeing the network. It was not necessarily about the maps. The other frustration from day one is that every icon was supposed to have eight attributes visible to you. And originally, it was in color. Object, it was two-way message capable, and there was a human at the console. If it was gray, although it doesn't show up as much, this is gray, that one's white. If it's gray, it's a tracker. It does not have two-way message capability. It might be on some inanimate object. If it is blue, light blue, it has been dead reckoned. And dead reckoning means that was the last known position. And it's frustrating to me that a lot of software puts a car there. The car wasn't there 1 millisecond after that packet was transmitted because it's moving at 60 miles an hour down the highway. So APRS was always built around dead reckoning, and most of the other follow-on applications didn't do that. And so you see these icons all over the place, and you can't tell if they've been there for 3 days, 3 hours, or they're 10 minutes old. Those authors said, well, I'm not going to dead reckon this thing because after 10 minutes, this thing's going to be all the way over here in this neighborhood. Yes, but on the original APRS DOS concept, the concept was, there's the position. This line with this icon moving is just showing you the passage of time that has elapsed since that thing was valid. And sure, your map really gets messy with these things flying in the Navy. They're called zoomers. But that's simply showing you how less and less valuable that symbol is, because it's been dead reckoned so far that who knows where it is now. Then there, a station could send, you could put an alarm on a station that says, if it moves, you know, let me know. So those were red. Purple objects are they're objects that somebody else put on the map. And when you put something on the map, you can give it a speed, because remember, original APRS would dead reckon that thing once it was put on the map and continue to move it at speed. A yellow object was something, an object that you're transmitting, that you have put on the map. And then there's one other color. Oh, dark blue means the that object has been killed, and it'll eventually fade out of the system. But again, once everybody went to Windows and just standard little icons, these eight dimensions of information were completely lost. And the other author says, no problem, they can click on the map and they can see this information. When you've got 300 things on the map at the EOC on the large projector, only the operator can go click on it. And so you've just thrown away 7/8 of the information that was supposed to be in APRS. Oh, and then there's one other color, which is, there's green, which is, means it's active as a digipeater, and then there's a weather station. And if it's blue, it is capable of doing weather. Once it's tied into the internet, of course, there's everything you can do with it. This is the original findyou.com, and you can go there, and when you click on an object, you see the map, then you can say, show me the nearby stations. It'll sort them by order. In distance, and of course you can see who has messages. You can click on there and see what their messages are. So this was the findyou.com that we had since 1997. Again, it shows kind of the Washington, Baltimore, Annapolis area, and there's probably 300 APRS users in the area over about a 40-mile stretch. But again, without that dead reckoning information, without that color dimension, you can't tell whether that's where that guy was 3 days ago, the last time he had his tracker on, or whether that's current. So to me, that map is practically useless. It's a lot of information. It's really neat, but it's not providing me real-time useful information. This is the current APRS.fi webpage. And it still has the single-dimensional symbols, but because he shows the track history, you can tell, at the end of each one of these tracks, there's a vehicle somewhere, that guy. So now you can see that it still doesn't tell you necessarily whether that's real time, but at least you can see he's moving, and that's where he is at this point. And the way you can tell how old it is by this window. You want to change this from 3 hours and change it back to 15 minutes, and boom, everybody that's older than 15 minutes is going to disappear. So that's a very good way of seeing how real-time things are. Fantastic capability of this APRS.fi. And again, you can click on anybody and see their messages. And on findyou.com, you could click on that from your shack potato position and send that guy a message, even if he's in mobile on the other side of the world. Because Steve Dempsey says, we have no security. It's ridiculous to think that we have security. And if we added layers upon layers of ways for you to build in security, they're all defeatable. So I'm just going to make it wide open and show you how bad it is. It turns out, I don't think we've heard of anybody abusing the system. So far, it's working. The scope of APRS, 40,000 users worldwide, and that was about 5 years ago. I'm not sure to say that it's growing that much anymore. You've basically got your 5% of ham radio operators who think APRS is pretty good, and the other 95% are just never ever going to try it, because all it is vehicle tracking, right? Why? What value is that? So let's look at APRS touch tone. Now this is. If you go to Dayton and turn on your radio, and in 10 minutes, because people arrive over several days, but you'll get up to 300 or more APRS users there. But this is showing APRS touch tone. How many people then just send in their DTMF code? And if all they do is send in their call sign, That's all we know is their call sign. But we know that it was heard by the guy's booth right there that was running APRS touch tone on his laptop. And so he said, okay, every person that I hear simplex DTMF, I'm going to build a table over here on the map in the trees, because there's nobody going to park in the trees over here at Dayton. And so that's a good place for this APRS TT engine to put its list of people that have checked in without a position. Now, if you also send your call sign and enter two digits of latitude and two digits of longitude, then we can put you on the map any particular place you want to be, even including indoors. This is showing, you know, how to build an APRS system. But these days, this is the tiny track 4. Now we're finally getting to the trackers being two-way devices. So now they can do what APRS was always about, and that is have a display in front of the mobile operator so that he can see what's going on in the world around him. And so the tiny track 4 added the display kit. I think it was a $20 display or something else. And this tiny tracker, you just hook it up to the speaker and mic of a radio, and now you've got full APRS capability. Hook the GPS into the GPS port on this thing, and now all of the position reports that you see from everybody else, of course, get sent over to the GPS as waypoints. So now you can see on your GPS map everybody that's around you. So we have the tiny tracker, which now has added display. The open tracker, I find it impossible to follow his web page to see what in the world he's doing. But I think he has a display. I'm not sure.
It utilizes the new V350.
Oh, that's right. It uses the attached GPS, which has a key. You know, you got the little touch screen for sending and receiving messages. Okay, so the open tracker can do it. And now, what I haven't had time to make a slide. I do have a slide that I made for tomorrow's pitch, but this is my canned pitch, which I've been given for years. Is the YAG tracker. The advantage of the YAG tracker is it does almost everything that the Kenwood radio can do and more, because now these original ones here, they just kind of capture a packet, put it on the map, and you can see it when it first comes in, but it's not saving them all so that you can go back and look at them. Whereas the YAG tracker now does that for the last 50 stations, and of course the Kenwood does it for the last 100 stations, but there's a big difference in price.
Ham HUD could store up the last 48.
Oh, okay. Now, is a new ham HUD in production, or is
it? No, the ham HUD's kind of being replaced by the
AG. I think so.
Unfortunately.
Yeah, the ham HUD, did I have it in any of my pictures?
Way back.
Yeah, way back. The ham HUD was the first, you know, cottage industry response that says, you know, a lot of us don't want to go out and buy the Kenwood or the AZ radio, and so we should have a little device that we just hook up to the speaker and mic, and away we go. And the ham HUD was it. Fantastic. Sold them all out. And I think it got caught in the web of, wow, we could do so much more with it, and we could do so much more with it, and we could do so much more with it, that it never got finished.
Well, what happened was there was a complete redesign of the hardware to kind of utilize newer technology, and unfortunately, feature bloat kind of took over,
right.
And it basically kind of got dropped. Then the YAG tracker came along, and I
the YAG tracker. I can show you a slide on the YAG tracker later. But it's basically, you know, a box that interfaces the radio. But now you have this display, and it's not just a text display. It's a graphics display. So you can see a map and see things in scale and all that kind of stuff. Well, in fact, he's got them in the other room. So, you know, go over there and look at them.
Yeah, I've got a working demo, and I even have units here for sale.
Great. Now here's what I'm talking about, the D710. Added the 8 additional bytes so that not only do you see everybody in the list, you see what frequency they're on, you push the tune button, and the radio instantly tunes to it. In addition, what's new on the newer radios is you can sort. You can sort by call sign, by distance, and by time. The value of sorting by distance is I'm driving through a town, and of course I've always got 100 stations in my list, and I want to see, well, what's the closest ones? I just hit sort, distance, and all of a sudden I see that there's a guy 2 miles away from me coming my direction. You know, pretty valuable. And I believe the YAG tracker can sort by distance.
And you can sort by distance and time.
And
I'm going to see about this doing sorting by alphabetical.
And I'll show you why sorting by alphabetical is valuable. You say, well, that puts all the W call signs at the end and all the A call signs at the beginning. But what comes before the A call signs? All of the objects on the map that are repeater frequencies. So now, that's what I've done here. I've sorted by alphabetic, and the top three objects are repeater objects. And that's the other thing that APRS has been doing since 2004, is you don't need no stinking repeater directory. I mean, has anybody ever really been able to use the repeater directory? You pull it, you drive through Washington, D.C., you pull out the repeater directory. There's only 100 repeaters. Which one are you going to, you know, who are you going to call?
Which ones are actually still on the air?
Or are still on the air, or is there really a human at the other end? And so, to me, that's always been pretty useless. I said, let the repeaters that are of value, that the local community agrees, this is the one we want the traveler to be aware of, that should be a beacon on APRS every 10 minutes, 24 hours a day, so that the guy driving down the road, boom, when he sees a frequency on the front panel of his radio, he knows he's in simplex range of it, otherwise he wouldn't have received it. And not only does it show the frequency, but when you push the tune button, it also has the PL tone and the shift and everything else. So again, one button tuning while you're driving down the road. And you didn't have to load a CD before you left. And of course, like I say, Yaesu now, Yaesu has four models of APRS radio, and away we go. Now, what a lot of people don't realize is that the D710 APRS control head, which is the cat's meow, just like the FTM350 display head, shows you everything you want to know as an APRS driver about APRS going on around you. All of that functionality in the Kenwood is built into the control head. So when you take the control head, undo the two cords, take it in to your office desk, you can hook it up to an HT, and now you have the same full APRS functionality on that HT. Here, just for fun, we plugged it into the little data port or the audio port on the back of a D-Star radio. And now the guy has APRS on the left side of his radio, and he's got D-Star on the right side. So finally, yes?
Can you put a 710 display on a 700?
Oh, absolutely. You can put it on any radio. Oh, but it's notice he said it correctly. It's a display head. I don't use it when I'm talking to it. I don't call it a control head anymore, because if I hook it up to my IC2AT, it's not going to control it. Okay, so you lose the radio control capability. And, of course, the number one thing that's new in APRS over the last 7 years now is this addition of frequency and having the radio automatically insert what frequency you're on, and when it receives a frequency, to be able to automatically tune it. You lose that capability because, again, the D710 control head cannot talk back to an old D700. Yeah.
A radio D710 control head will do that? Does it have to be RC D710?
The control head can do it. The RC D710, when you buy that as a standalone unit, it comes with a little power supply.
Gotcha.
Because you got to power this thing.
No, Bob, that's not true. When you buy the RC D710 by itself, it doesn't come with anything. That's why we developed our interface box. We have an interface box we developed that goes between the head and any other radio. We call it our RC D710 interface.
But it'll work with the D710 control head.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, there is a production difference, and now they put that difference in all the original, all the ones that come with the radio. They have to have a beeper in there, because you lose the speaker when you do this. Okay. And so now, you know, the beep, you've got mail, the beep, you've got a new station, that was all lost. So when you bought the RC D710, it had the little beeper in the back. And at that point, and that was a couple of years ago, they changed production and put that little piezoelectric beeper in all of them so that they can be used interchangeably.
See, Kenwood actually came out with their own similar interface, so you could do that, connect their head to anything. But it's about a third more expensive than our interfaces. And ours is much easier to work with because it has a power pole.
Gotcha.
And it's got a standard 6-pin mini-DIN interface, and you can take the included mini-DIN to main-DIN cable we include, you plug it in, you plug it into the data port of any mobile, and you're plug and playing up and running.
Here I've plugged in the D710 head into an $88 Alinco, and now what's sandwiched between them, I'm not sure if you can see it, but it's a whole bunch of NiCads to power this guy. It takes about 350 milliamps. To power the display head.
And the head needs 10 volts DC. It's a really odd voltage.
Yeah, it's 10 volts.
So we have a 10 volt regulator in our box to take care of that.
If you give it 12, just get unhappy.
You will burn it up.
You'll burn it up. It's really, it wants 8 volts, but you know, it 10 volts regulates down to 8. So anything from 8 to 10 unregulated will work, but not 12 volts.
We found 10 volts DC regulated was the most stable in our testing.
So in addition to the Yaesu now has entered the market, like again, we've always had the Hab HUD for a number of years, and then the Elinco has the built-in TNC, but it does not interface with the radio, so you have to plug in, you know, a laptop or something to do that.
And for that Elinco, if you put in Scott's version of the Tracker 2,
good point.
Now you can plug a new V350 into that and have full messaging capability, and the TNC is now built into the radio.
Yeah, so this radio is, I don't know, 160 bucks
without
the TNC. So you buy it without the TNC, and what he's telling you is buy Argent Data Technologies little TNC that fits in there in the same place that the one they sell, and now you've got all these two-way capabilities and everything else. Not to the radio front panel, but then to the Nuvi GPS, which is your display. And by the way, the Nuvi GPS, you know, is your standard old GPS.
And of course, if you don't have a Nuvi, you can plug just a standard serial GPS into it, and it will still operate as a tracker, even though I know that's not your favorite thing.
Right.
It will.
Is that a 350?
Nuvi 350.
Is that a 350 you've got right there, Bob?
Yeah, it's a 350, but you can't get these anymore, right?
You want a bidding on that now?
Well, that's what I was just going to say. Your best source now are the refurbs that pop up on eBay for, you know, 100 and a quarter.
Yeah, they don't make them anymore, and he's been knocking his head out, and he cannot get Garmin to fix the bugs they have in all their other GPS models.
However, I think it's the Oregon or one of the new handhelds came out. They are now toting that it has an NMEA interface.
Oh.
They are starting to listen. Garmin's starting to listen.
Now, what you have to go back now is look at this. This is the AVMAP GPS made in Italy, but they are 100% believers of APRS. So they will modify their product to do what APRS needs.
They also charge you nearly.
Yeah, it was an $800 GPS, so you didn't see a lot of them. But the beautiful thing about it was the APRS position reports that came in, it had all 200 APRS symbols built in. So if it was a boat, it was a boat. If it was an airplane, it was an airplane. All the other GPSs are going to display just a dot and a call sign, except for the Nuvi 350, which has 50 different symbols. They're not APRS symbols, but there's a good mapping between those 50 to the 200 we've got. And so if you see a bus, you'll see a bus, you know, on this thing.
And just for the future of the Yag Tracker, it will have the Kimberlin support that is going to be added.
So it'll be able to output. Oh, and by the way, the latest version of the AVMAP is now down around $400. And not only that, but it does have the text interface. Text is, you know, you bring up the keyboard and you can type a message there and it gets transmitted out through these devices. Now, this is a web page, and if you go there, every one of those things is a link, and every one of them is saying what people don't understand about APRS. And I'm not going to go through each one of them because I'm kind of hitting them as I go. Now, APRS growth opportunities. From day one, the first thing we needed was, I've been now for 11 years trying to get a version of APRS Touchtone so that you can do this DTMF thing. But one of the first things that got added was adding global email. Keith Sproul, is it Sproul or Sproul?
Sproul.
It's Sproul. Keith Sproul. I'm going to start saying it that way. Keith Sproul has this engine W2Z, and if you send an APRS message from anywhere on the planet to email, and the first word of that email is somebody's email address, then the rest of that message gets pulled off of the APRS and sent to the guy as email. So that was done years and years ago. The other thing we needed was like for field day. You go out for field day and you've worked all, you know, 10 other states in the DC area. I might even find 5 other APRS people actually out at field day, and you're done. Well, no, you got the whole planet full of other field days going on. It's just that you don't know where you can't. Everything goes into the internet, but nothing comes back out to RF unless you know the guy's call sign. So all you need is to know is the call sign at the other end. So I asked Pete, AE5PL, if he would write what we call CQ server. CQ server is another engine that's just sitting there watching the entire global APRS system. If you send a message to CQ server, and the first two words of your message are CQ scouts, anybody else on the planet who has sent a message to CQ server with the first two words being CQ scouts, the server will now turn around and send that message back out to everybody that's done that. So it's a way of establishing global, instantaneous, on-demand chat rooms or message groups on the fly. And then originally we wanted it for CQ Field Day. You say CQ Field Day, we are MDC Maryland 3A. And I would send that message once, and it would go out to everybody else who had sent their similar message. Now, of course, you could see we could melt. We got 40,000 users, right? And we only got a 1,200 baud channel. So to make sure it didn't melt down, we said you can only send one message every 30 minutes. If you send one any more often than that, it's going to reject it and say you're transmitting too often. Well, we've never had that problem because, remember, you packet at field day doesn't get no respect anyway. Nobody could care less that you're talking halfway around the world with APRS. So the couple of examples is, again, CQ Field Day, CQ Scouts, and you know, anytime, anywhere, if you send a message to CQ Scouts, if anybody else has done that in the last 24 hours, then they'll get your message, and so you could, you know, Scouts could get together. JOTA, Jamboree on there, CQ IOTA, Islands on the Air. You know, Saturn is a good example. CQ Saturn. Saturn, you know, is the Salvation Army radio corps. Well, and Salvation Army, you know, they deploy to Haiti or wherever something is. Well, by if they, each person that was on the air in the Salvation Army, if they just sent a message to CQ server saying, CQ Saturn, we are headed for Haiti, boom, for the next 24 hours, everybody else who has done that now can exchange messages all over the planet. Great capability. APRS touched on, I'll talk about automatic voice relay system. That's what all of tomorrow is about. And it says, from day one, back in 2000, when I realized that I have text capability anywhere on the planet, and Echolink has voice capability anywhere on the planet, why don't we just tie two together so that I just say call sign QSO question mark, means I want to establish a QSO. And the AVRS engine is sitting there watching all this traffic. It says, oh, Bob wants to talk to W3XYZ. And it looks up on the APRS system and sees that I am at BWI Airport. It looks up the other guy's call sign and sees he's in Monterey, California. It looks up the nearest Echolink node to me. And it sends me a message that says, go to 147.105 Echolink. And it sends this guy a message to go to whatever his frequency of the nearest Echolink. I get that message. And with the new Kenwood radio, because it has a frequency in it, I just hit OK. And I am connected, and I can have voice. That is what I wanted to do since the year 2000. And it's so frustrating that we've had the capability, and all we need is one person to write the AVRS engine, and we can do this.
It's done, Bob.
Oh.
I've been sitting here for the last 2 days finishing up. It's done.
Finishing up. All right. And we're gonna hear about it tomorrow. So we're really looking forward to this. About 9 months ago, I realized D-Star has already done it. D-Star has global call-sign-to-call-sign connectivity. And if you were here the previous hour, you saw how that worked. And so I've said, okay, let's tie in. Instead of waiting for this to get written, let's just write an A-star gateway instead of a D-star gateway so that the A-star gateway looks like D-star on one side of it, but it, on the other side it looks like APRS. And what is APRS? It's a voice radio that can signal who you want to talk to, and it can display who you're talking to. That's what D-star is. And that's one their number one objections to tying in any analog system is they can't see who you're talking to because they're so used to seeing everybody's call sign. No, we can do that. Remember, from day one, the APRS has had the ability to periodically send your beacon, or it can send it every time you release your push-to-talk button and send it as part of the end of your QSO. So anyhow, we got all this stuff. APRS, RFI. So, okay, so here's the D-Star. D-Star goes into this big D-Star cloud, and you can talk to anybody on the planet as long as you know what its call sign is and talk to anybody else. Well, why can't an A-Star node sit on the D-Star cloud just like every other D-Star node does, and it handshakes this direction as if it was D-Star, but over here it's telling you what frequency to go to, it is telling you who's calling you, and it already knows your call sign. And so, you know, we've had it. Think of this as the telephone instrument. We just need to provide the connectivity. Going to talk about this tomorrow. I've already talked about email, and this is typically what the email looked like on the now 14-year-old walkie-talkie. It's about a 45 message text, 45 character text that you can send. There's your global CQs. Now, how do you encode your call sign? And it is, we're currently using this 12 characters method, you know, where you punch the letter A is you push the 2 key and then A, which means it's the first one, or the letter V, you push the 8 key and then you push C because it's the third letter on that key. And you say, why are we using that method? That's not a very popular one. The reason is because it's guaranteed then that a 6-letter call sign will always fit into 12 digits. Some of the other encoding methods, such as is actually used by this, there's multiple key presses, and some strange call signs could be relatively long. So anyhow, that's the method we used up. But anyway, when I send the DTMF call sign, boom, what actually then, that gets converted by the APRS TT engine into a packet, which has my latitude, my longitude, what frequency I'm on, and you know, and what's going on. That APRS TT engine that heard me has already been preloaded with what's going on today, so that everybody that hears gets that information added onto its packet. The APRS TT spec that I wrote has everything else in the world in it, where you could enter, you know, a 2-digit number or a 4-digit number or anything. You can specify your position. For a marathon that's 27 miles long, you know, you could decide that for this event, you're just going to use 2 digits to indicate what mile marker you're at in the marathon. And so you enter 2 digits, and the APRS TT engine translates that to the lat long of that position along the course. So don't think in terms of thinking inside the box that every position has to be a lat long. No, it can be just about anything you agree with beforehand for your event. And the APRS TT engine is, like I say, could be just sitting in a laptop, and it allows all the DTMF users to communicate with all the APRS users, both send and receive. And you say, well, wait a minute, how can I receive a message on my old IC2AT? And the answer is by voice, you know. You don't have enough going there where you could play a voice coming back at you, do you? I said, you don't have something, an example there where you can speak back in voice.
I can have tomorrow, I don't have today.
Okay, so anyway, the idea is, when you send in your call sign, blah, 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 the repeater comes back and says, welcome, WB4APR. Not only does that give me confirmation that it got my call sign correct, but now everybody else at that repeater heard that I'm on the air. It's the same thing as me getting in the car and saying, this is WB4APR mobile. We've accomplished the same thing, but the difference is, when I do it by voice, it goes no further than the ears that are on the air at that moment listening to that repeater. If I do it by DTMF, the APRS TT engine speaks it, and then the whole world gets a packet that knows that you've just turned on the air on that repeater. Now, how's it going to show up on the map? Well, this is the voice repeater that heard the DTMF user, and all it does is it starts building a table geographically on the map of everybody that it's heard. So everybody on the APRS map, whether it's APRS.fi or any other map in the world, they're going to see these guys building a nice little regular table above that a repeater that they were heard on. And remember the example where we had APRS TT at Dayton, and we just chose to put that list over in the corner so that it was out of the way of the parking lot where nobody else would be in the same place that the list showed up. So here's how we reported our position at Dayton. Oh, it's only using 2 digits. Remember, there was one guy that reported he was right here. He entered 00. My parking lot up here was 16. The location of the APRS TT engine was 34. That gets you within 60 feet. That's the position of GPS, and it works indoors. You just push DTMF memory 0, blah, 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 33. You just put yourself on the map to the whole world that you're in that location. You're in the north room at Dayton. And again, this is what the map looked like. A whole lot about that. Oh, here's something. Again, it's probably too late. There were 300,000 radios manufactured by Yaesu FT. That's Yaesu, right? Yaesu and Kenwood that had full DTMF two-way communications. They exchanged call signs every time you pushed your PTT, and there were up to 10 characters, I think, of text. And I said, fantastic, we can do this. And so I made a little PIC processor. Well, I don't see it. Is that it? That says, okay, this radio, there are 300,000 out there, a little PIC processor can listen to the APRS channel, send out the DTMF codes on a simplex channel, and show me call signs every time somebody else checks in on APRS. By that same token, since my DTMF call sign goes out every time I transmit, that can be picked up by the local repeater and put over in APRS and show that I'm there. I wrote this, got it all going, but it just, where did these 300,000 radios go? I don't know. I've got two of them. Now, here's another example. How much time do I have? It is, what time is it?
It's after 4.
And I was supposed to stop at 4. Is somebody going to come in and tell us to leave?
I say keep going until they tell us.
Okay. Now, this is an example also like the, remember the runners at the marathon. This is Boy Scouts all over this field event where they have 20 different places. These are the Cub Scouts. These are the Boy Scouts. And at these 20 different checkpoints, we have 20 different hams that stand there with their HT, and every 45 minutes, the buzzer goes off, and now they're supposed to report the scores of the troops at their position. And the guys up in headquarters are writing down these 20 scores from 20 humans for 20 different troops. And this club has done this for years, and so I said, let's do this with APRS. And initially what I wanted to do was, you enter the score on the HT and it automatically goes into a scoring system and it's all done. No, that's getting into somebody else's turf and you don't want to cross turf lines. So I said, let me at least put this D700 control head on the clipboard that you use at headquarters. And you can use this or not. But what I'm going to do is every time I report, I'm going to send a message to NETCON, I'm going to give the troop number and the score. And so when the buzzer goes off, I enter the troop number, the score, I hit send, put the radio in my pocket, I'm done. I don't have to sit there and listen to the other 20 people check in, wait for my name to be called, and wait for me to then send in my data. It's going to go in automatically. Now, the old FUD, who's done this for the last 50 years, he said, okay, he'll give it a chance. After it was over, he said it was absolutely fantastic. Because he's sitting there. Remember what this guy's got. He's sitting there with 20 different people trying to give him information. He's trying to write it down. And, of course, at headquarters, there's all other kinds of interruptions and things going on. And so it's not an easy job. And, of course, you're out in the field. You hear silence. And, you'll call net control, and he'll say, stand by, because he's busy. He doesn't want to be interrupted right now. But with this system, the numbers just start, they just accumulate in the radio. Now, when all of a sudden the net control, who's the busiest guy there, has a moment, he can just move the cursor down to the next one, hit OK, and he got my score. Cursor down the next one, hit OK, he got my score. He can do it at his convenience, and he said it was just a godsend. Number one, because I'm not one, another 20 people on the net trying to get a word in edgewise. The information is just flowing. There was one other benefit. Oh, so the next year, we were up to 5 HTs. And the next year then, I said, we're going to add DTMF. So everybody, even with the old ICOM 2AT, can do it. Because all of a sudden we realized, anybody can download free DTMF receive and display software. All we're transmitting is numbers. So let's just let people with DTMF enter, send in, pre-programmed their checkpoint number, and then enter troop number, score, done. So we got this all set up. We showed up. Guess what? That year, every single person at every one of those checkpoints had an APRS radio. So we decided we weren't going to fuss with the DTF. It worked fine. So anyway, think outside the box. If there's anything, any event that you do where numbers are information that you need to process, you've had a radio for 12 years now that can do that in the palm of your hand. Last year, year before, we said, you can buy an RFID tag for $2. Oh, remember I said how hard it was to go through the, how do you build an antenna through the door? You don't. You buy a $6 doormat from Kmart, you put a little coil underneath it and make a big yellow spot and then spray paint it that says APRS. And now an APRS guy, he comes through a door and he sees a thing with a yellow spot on it that says APRS and he just steps on it. Because now the ID card, ID tag in his shoe will always register. And so we are able to use the 6-inch range RFID tags because the guy is motivated to report as he enters the room. So that way we could tell where people were at Dayton. And sure enough, I built six or seven of them, put them around Dayton. And any time an APRS guy wanted to swing his foot over that pad, we would see that he was at that location.
We should marry either one in front of our bed.
Say again?
Set one in front of our bed.
Set one in front of his booth so you could see who was standing in front of his thing. Of course, we've never used it since because it's an idea that's looking for an application. And we thought, well, wouldn't it be neat to put it, you know, at the door of the emergency operations center in our county? Because a couple of hams, you know, a couple of nights a week, they're over there doing something, and it's nice to know who's in the shack. And so if everybody just carried their card in their shoe, well, of course, you know, you could put a little yellow dot on the side of the wall that they do this as they go by, but nobody's going to do that. Reach in your pocket, pull this thing out just to send out a packet that says you're here. Put it in your shoe, and we always know where you are. But we didn't even do it for my own county because it's just, you know, it's just somebody's got to do it. Now, you had mentioned position reporting other than GPS. What we've had since day one in ham radio is, where are you? I'm at mile marker 230 on I-95. Okay. So APRS DOS back now 18 years ago, fundamental was it had the entire country mile marks, again, manually entered by me from the Rand McNally map, so that, and again, back then, I'm driving down the road, I'm talking to somebody, a guy named Joe on 5-2, and I say, Joe, where are you? And he says, well, I'm at mile mark 233. I say, which way are you going? And he says, you know, south. And so on my APRS mobile, I just, I say, show mile markers, I go to that one, put Joe as an object to that position and give him a speed of 60 miles an hour. And for the next hour while we're talking, he's moving down the map. Now notice he's not going to make this curve, but I know that. As time progresses and he's down here, I know that he's really over here. And if I want to, I can just hook that object, move it to here and re-enter him, and now he's back on the road and continuing. But anyhow, mile markers, it's also in UI view. And I just think we could do so much better with mile markers. For example, now if the guy just says, I'm on I-50, or I'm on 50, mile marker 33, in APR's DOS, you could either do it by putting them on the map by that, or you could just say mile mark, MD for Maryland, 50, and then 33. And then boom, it would instantly put him on the map at that location. Anyway, I think that's another touch tone application. You do dee-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee, it knows your call sign, and now you enter MM for mile marker, and what mile marker you just passed, and everybody in the world sees where you are. There's so much we can be doing with this stuff. I'm going to go ahead and, you know, we've had APRS in space. Anybody in here do mobile satellite comms? Remember, we've been doing amateur satellites for 40 years, and we haven't had PCs but for 20. And so we did all of our tracking back in the old days manually. And just by putting the highest pass in the morning and the highest pass in the evening, writing it down on a sheet of paper for 5 days, guess what? AO51 repeats every 5 days. So 5 days afterwards, the evening pass is going to be exactly 2000 again. So you'll notice what I did with the columns. I said this is the 1st of August, 2nd, 3rd, 4th, 5th, 6th, 7th of August. Da, 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 da. So yeah, this is the 1st, that's the 2nd, whatever. But this is also the 6th, the 7th. This is also the 12th, you know, so that thing will work for a couple of months. And not only is it this pass is the best pass, but you know that the orbit period is 90 minutes, so you know that 90 minutes before this one and 90 minutes after it is another pass. So you just print one of these out once every 3 months or so, stick it on your dashboard, and anytime, anywhere, you can just glance at your dashboard and see whether you've got a pass coming up. And remember, these FM satellites, you can work from your mobile. You don't have to have this big. You have to have this beam if you're going to talk to them on the horizon because they're 10 times further away. But when they get within that 2 or 3 minutes in the center, you can clearly close the link with your mobile. It's just that you don't know when that is, and you're not going to sit there and do a satellite pass prediction, which is what people think you have to do with a computer every single time you get in your car, so nobody does it. I wanted to write a program that would just print these automatically for you. You go to the web page, you click today's date, it would print this out, stick it on your dashboard for the next 3 months, you can work satellites. But now we have hardly any satellites anymore that work. This has nothing to do with APRS, but the reason I like to show this is because everybody thinks that satellites are up. They are not. Satellites are on the horizon. 70% of the time, they're below 20 degrees. That looks like a high angle. That's only 20 degrees, remember, because this is 45. They're only above 45 degrees for 6% of the total time that they're available. So I can talk a lot about solar, but I'm not. That's it. Any questions? Okay, tomorrow we're going to take most of the ideas I talked about here, and we're going to try to see if we can't get the D-Star people, the Echolink people, the ARRL people, APRS TT people, and everybody else. I should be able to use my HT and just a call sign. It's just like a phone number. It's unique in the world. I should be able to say who I want to talk to and say do it and let the system then hook us up. So that's what we're going to be doing tomorrow. Thank you. Any questions? Yes, sir.
Well, several months ago, you and I were chatting on the radio about the fact that the APRS ARRL book is way out of date, written by Stan Orzeff.
Oh.
Where do we stand on that? Any idea?
Oh, I don't know. I haven't read it in a while. I'd have to look at it and see. The problem is just my original docs, if I printed them out, would have been a ream of paper. And so there's just so much information, you don't know where to start. And no, I don't know if Stan's going to make a new one or not. And I don't know what you'd try to put in a book these days. See, to me, Stan's book was oriented around, you know, got the Mac APRS, you got Win APRS, you got UIView, or you got APRS DOS. This is what you're going to see. We don't have that anymore because you can't even have a laptop in the front of your car anymore. To me, APRS was always about what do I see in the mobile, and that has all been solved by Kenwood and Yaesu and everybody else now that's putting it on the front panel of the radio, and that's to me what APRS was all about. So if anything other, if he was to write the book again, you know, you'd have a few introductory paragraphs or chapters about the internet and all that other kind of stuff, but it's mostly about what can you do with this thing in the palm of your hand and what can you do with that display on your dashboard. And I hope the things I want to see when I'm mobile is, and you know, if I'm traveling, I want to see those frequencies pop up every time I get in range of the locally recommended traveler's repeater. So instantly I can start up a conversation with somebody without trying to guess at PLs and without having to go to a repeater record. So that's number one. Frequencies just show up on the radio, and the radios are already built, so now I can tune to them with the push of a button. Number two, I want to see there's a net in progress. Oh, by the way, that frequency object that is transmitted every 10 minutes from every repeater, in that one packet is included not only the frequency, the tone, the offset, but also the weekly meeting net times, Tuesday, 3 p.m., or 9 p.m., and the monthly meeting times. All that information is available to you when you drive within range of a repeater. That, to me, is what APRS is about. It's informing you of local information that you need as a mobile operator. So those frequency objects. The next thing I'm looking for is anybody who's near me, you know, that I see on the map that has their frequency, because now I can talk to them. If I see a tracker coming at me who has no two-way communications capability, doesn't tell me what frequency he's on, there's nothing I can do. It's a cute little icon moving down the map. I have no interest in that because I can't communicate with him, and that's what ham radio is all about. So that's, to me, what the radio is what can it display to me that is going on in real time around me. Any other questions? I want to thank you so much for being here, and like I say, come here tomorrow and let's see what you put together. I'm really excited about this. Oh, by the way. Now, you're writing APRS touch tone.
APRS.
AVRS, okay, the automatic voice relay system. And the in preparation for this workshop tomorrow, I've been trying to get the Echolink author, Jonathan, for 10 years to accept DTMF call signs on the input and then send a packet over to APRS that says, this guy just checked in. You want that. For the last 5 years, I've been trying to ask him to, when I send a message to a call sign and somebody is on Echolink with a chat channel opened, that message that I sent on APRS should show up on his Echolink chat page. By the same token, if somebody is on Echolink chatting and they send a chat text to some call sign, I want a copy of that to go out on APRS so that if I'm not on Echolink but I'm driving around to 7-Eleven, that the message comes in there. So that's where this universal texting comes from. So anyway, in preparation for tomorrow's meeting, Jonathan actually finally said, oh, that's a good idea. the DTMF call sign and then sending a message over to APRS to show your presence on echolink. All-Star, I had only recently heard about All-Star, but Jim Dixon, I guess, writes the All-Star software, which is this all-in-one software. You just hook up two radios to your audio ports, and now you are a node in the All-Star network. He said he'll do it. In fact, he's already done it. So now he's putting that on the input. I mean, he hasn't distributed or anything else. He's still playing with it. But again, now he's saying, okay, yeah, if you come up on an All-Star node and you send in this DTMF touch tone code, he'll grab it and he'll send a packet into the APRS information system. So again, now we're starting to have the presence. And that's what I always wanted was everything that's listening for DTMF, please listen for call signs. And if you see it, tell us that the guy just checked in, because now you can add that information as to where you heard him, and we know how to get back to it. Any more questions? Good. Well, I want to look over your shoulder there, John, and see what you what you wrote.
I'm in the debugging mode.
Yeah. will it receive a if I stand here and enter it, send a DTMF? Will it?
No, won't do DTMF. If you send a
You send a message, yeah.
Yeah, if you send a message right now, we'll see it show up here. I'm not sure you're going to get the right response yet, but it's real close. Here's a query I did earlier, right?
Whoops, let me find my.
And I'm just using APRS Droid by George.
Yeah,
Lucas,
the Droid, right?
But and it's all going over the internet. I'm not doing any of this over RF, it will work. But so I said, okay. Let's see here. Show me. I wanted to set up. Well, let's go back here. I queried. I sent a message to AVRS. I want to know where AB010.
Call sign question mark.
Call sign. I send the question mark. Mm-hmm. Comes back, and this is something real close here. Mm-hmm. This is 147.580, tone 100, echo link node 69063 is 7.54 miles away.
And that's real.
That's real. That's honest to God, and it's echo link and IRLP data are updated every 5 minutes. Node status.
Okay. Uh-huh.
So I'm doing a pull of every node online every 5 minutes.
Oh, and it gives me the range.
It gives you the range. Now I can also give you bearing if you're interested in that. Mm-hmm. If you've got a beam, but most people, and I've got room to do it. We just need to make sure it's going to fit on the face of a D72. Now here's one I wanted to do. I want to set up a call with N4AC, my buddy down in Georgia.
Okay. So this is a message.
Yeah. It's a message from me, AB00-10, to AVRS, and just the text of the message was his call sign.
Right.
Now, there's a couple things, and I don't want to go too far out off the reservation right now, but N4AC's got six call signs, six SSIDs, right? So now I've got to have an algorithm that says, all right, which is the one that Randall's most likely to be at?
Right.
All right, well, if he's got a D72, mm-hmm. I bet he's there. So if I look for my -7 SSID first,
okay.
And even better, if I can figure out, hey, it's a D72 by its destination call, hey, we'll go there first. If I don't get mine a D72, maybe I'll look at his -9 call.
Right.
All right. Now I've exhausted those two. So now I need to maybe say, which one of these has an equal sign versus an exclamation point? Which one is messaging capable?
Yeah.
So then I go, down the list until eventually you say, well, there's nothing left. I'm just going to send it to one of them and hope he gets it.
And of course, one of the advantages of an APRS message, if you send it to any SSID, all of the guy's other stations will capture it, but only the one that has the exact match will send back an ACK.
Right.
So they'll all get a copy of it. But
now if I get a NAC, a reject, because there are, and I don't know if the track is like, if Tiny Track does this.
People's messages get full and they don't read them.
Oh, and so that's what happens.
And then it sends a reject.
Well, but do things like one-way trackers, I guess one-way trackers couldn't, but just like Tiny Track 4, which is a two-way capable device, will it send a NAC or a reject?
No, the only thing it'll send back the reject is...
Is if your mailbox is full or your...
Well, or something that could receive messages and now says I can't receive them anymore.
I'm not interested. Okay.
So, there's no reason to send anything if it doesn't have the capability of receiving it.
But the AVRS server does know, hey, and that's something the next step here is, so now you want to set up a link with him. I send you, here's your local node. I'm going to send him, here's his local node. Oh, I got an ACK from him. I need to tell you, hey, I got his ACK.
Oh,
he's
good.
Ready to go.
Yeah, all right.
At least his radio acknowledged.
Yeah, his radio's
his
alive.
His radio alive, yes. I did get an ACK for this message. Now, whether or not he's going to be able to come up on frequency, I can't tell you, but I can tell you that his radio ACK'd me.
Yeah, that is good.
So that's the next step. So I kind of want to whiteboard the flow of what needs to happen
And I've got some of these, I've got a kind of a block diagram and a decision tree here. So how do we figure out who we should, which SSID we should send the message to? And I think I got that pretty much figured out. -7, -9, assuming people play the right SSID rules, which I wish you would have talked about. I should have brought that up.
Well, there's one other thing, and that is that from day one, or well, at least for 10 years, I've wanted to have an operator present bit. Mm. And APRS DOS has it. And what it means is if the guy's touched his mouse or touched his keyboard or anything else, he's operator present. And I was looking for bits in the existing APRS protocol that I could use for that wouldn't screw anything else up. And what I found is the capitalization or not capitalization of the north and west symbols.
Mm.
Okay. And so I said, well, great, since everybody out there, you know, the spec says they will be capital letters. Therefore, if I said a lowercase letter, that's something new, and it says there is an operator present.
Yeah, that would be an operator present.
The problem was, oh, but UIView, the guy died,
mm-hmm,
8 years ago,
yeah.
It does not recognize lowercase. So now the operator presence disappeared from all the UI views.
Oh,
so I said, that's one of the reasons I've been waiting for UI view to die, because then I could use that bit to show operator presence.
Well, could you reverse it and have the capital be present because and assume
default
is but
all
present 40, if unknown?
Well, yeah, but all 40,000 things out there then look like they're operator present.
Well, could you use the symbol code to, like, throw out the weather stations and whatnot where there's no one sitting there anyway?
Oh, okay. But you're right. So I finally gave up and realized I've either got to wait for UI view to die, and then I can let the lowercase be it, or we can say uppercase means you're present, and all 40,000 people are present until all that software is replaced and starts sitting. That's not going to happen. So then you're right. I said, let's just... two or three years ago, I said, let's allow overlay characters on any symbol. And so if you put an O on your symbol, no matter what it is, that means there's an operator present.
Well, and there's other things, too. I mean, if you have a D710 and it's mobile, and I can say, because I can look at history, and I can say, I'm overlaying on top of, even if I'm saying, and I have a database with all 40,000 active APRS symbols, and so when I go to update that, first thing I do is I pull and I say, hey, has the position changed? If the position's changed, I set a flag in the database that says this is not the same position it was previously. Mm. Therefore, this guy is mobile. And then I also insert the timestamp. So I can say, if this guy was mobile in the last 5 minutes, chances are he's still mobile.
Yeah, right.
Therefore, that is and it's a D710 because I get that in the
symbol code?
The symbol, not the symbol code, but the destination
the
code.
Oh,
the two call.
Right.
The destination code tells me what type of device it is. So if it's a message capable radio and it's mobile, chances are the guy's got it somewhere where he can hear his message or he can get the message. Mm-hmm. So there's assumptions you can make there, but I think they're going to be valid 90% of the time.
Mm-hmm.
And then, but now if I get one and I've got a couple choices, I got his -7 and his -9 hasn't moved for an hour, the -7 has moved in the last 5 minutes. I know he stopped, he parked his truck, he got out and he's walking through the woods or whatever he's doing. So those are things, and I actually learned a lot about this playing with this APRS alert, which is I haven't told you about this yet. I mentioned it on the list. It's a website that is basically an APRS to SMS translation gateway. Mm-hmm. And what you do is you go in and you set up stations that you're interested in. For example, I have a tracker in my 18-year-old daughter's Beetle.
Yeah, right.
All right, so I want to know. So I know what its call sign is. I'm interested in that Beetle. So what I'll do is I'll go in and I can set up geographic zones using a Google Map interface, mm-hmm, and I put one around her high school. And I say, I want to know if that Beetle leaves that high school zone between 8:30 and 4:30 Monday through Friday. And it will send a text message to my cell phone if my daughter leaves school, if the tracker exits the zone.
Right.
Well, the other thing I use, and this is the...
What's that site called?
It's called aprs-alert.net, and I'll demo it tomorrow. The other thing, and the use case I use is, I'm a race director. I'm working a century bike ride.
Yes.
Right? So I've got 3 sag wagons out there. Now, the race director is not a ham, but she does have a cell phone. She wants to know whenever the lead racer hits the 25, 50, and 75 mile and 2 miles from the finish line, so she can have everything in place. And then she wants to know the trail rider when they hit those same points. So I have sag one, sag two. I set up 100 or 150 meter radius points around the route in those points. I label them 25 mile mark, 50 mile mark.
I enter her phone number in, and I say, when SAG 1 hits a 25-mile mark, send a text message that says this has happened to this phone. So all she has to do, I don't even have to have a shadow on her all day long. All she does, she has her cell phone, boom. Hey guys, we got our lead cyclist is 2 miles out. Let's go strike up the band. He's gonna be coming through the gate in just a minute.
Wow.
And so I've got about 200 users right now that are using APRS Alert for various things. The next stage that I'm about ready to release is it will track National Weather Service alert boxes. So I'm driving along, all of a sudden I get an APRS message or a text message saying you have just entered an active severe thunderstorm warning area.
Now, who wrote APRS Alert?
I did.
Oh, okay. It's, well, you spoke of it as a third party.
No. It's about 15,000 lines of code.
And it's out there for prime time?
It is prime time. It is locked and loaded. Yeah. And actually, I'm using the same engine to do AVRS stuff as well. I've got the same database.
It's looking at everything,
It's already looking at everything that comes in anyway, so I'm multitasking on that one database.
Well, you have been busy since. You know, that was just last December.
It was.
I thought it was years ago.
I went looking
for something, and I couldn't believe it was December.
Yeah. So I had AVRS working great, and then like all good coders, I monkeyed with it and broke it.
Yeah.
And the version that I had working, I never checked into source control.
Right.
So I've had to spend the last couple of days rejiggering it.
Yeah.
But I'm very, very close to having it back. I'd also got sidetracked a lot on APRS Alert because I had to do all the web page design.
Oh yeah.
There's a lot of cool JavaScript. Plus I had to do a Google Maps interface, which was much different than I expected it to be. So yeah, there were some things on there that were harder that have taken my time. But tomorrow, we can make AVRS works, and it does it for IRLP and Echolink. I need to make it work for AllStar, and we need to figure out
the VSTAR
stuff.
Is AllStar flash to plan, or is it something that's?
I
see some people kind of wrinkle their nose sometimes.
Well, yes and no. I mean,
is it an ego? Are there some egos that are involved that are just going to? You know, sometimes you can have the greatest idea, but the personalities.
I don't want to speak ill of anything or anyone. Echolink requires IRLP requires custom hardware, right? You got to go buy the, there's very limited places you can install it.
Right.
Echolink is a lot more open than that, but it still requires some. Not really fancy hardware, but it still requires an additional hardware interface. It looks like AllStar, and they're both. Echolink or IRLP is based on a TeamSpeak codec, which you can't get.
Right.
It's frozen in time in 1998. It looks like IRLP is actually based on a codec that's more open source. You can actually get to.
You mean AllStar?
Well, IRLP you can actually get to the codec too.
Oh, okay, go.
AllStar seems to be built on just straight VoIP, either GSM or H.264 or some standard codec that anybody can have.
Right.
And I think he's building it on top of some asterisk interface stuff, too.
Yes, it says asterisk.
And so that is much, much closer to the everybody can play the game, and I don't need to...
Right.
So, again, there's the issue of you got to have one central control point so all the nodes can check in.
Do you know whether he has redundancy there?
I don't know. I don't know that for sure. I've not dug... I'll dig into it deeper tonight and see if I can get real smart on it and give you those answers tomorrow. I just started looking at it, and I'm playing with some voice over IP stuff too. I don't want to put another boat in the water until it's going to be a battleship and
it looks like I said though, he did overnight. He added the call sign reception and he sent it in the packets and stuff. And what was the next thing he was? Oh, I said the very next thing I want you to do is when you receive a call sign.
He's receptive to changes.
He's receptive.
Well, and Jonathan has been pretty receptive to my requests for, you know, I actually got Jonathan and the IRLP guy to both code me a web page that gives me identical information. It's still in a slightly different format, but it's a web services. I hit it. I suck down all the nodes, whether they're active, latitude, longitude, and it all gets blown into the. I can actually use the same database table on the back end. And I just have a flag that indicates what type of node it is, so I can just now add a third link. It's an AllStar link.
Okay, now I remember what he came in with, and again, you know, this is all over my head. I said, you know, when a guy sends in his DTMF code, he's checking in, and if there's any traffic for him, I want the repeater says, you have mail.
Mm-hmm.
1, 2, 3. So you say, I want number one, and it plays back, just like an answering machine.
Sure.
And he said, sure, sure, he can do that. And then the next message I got from him, he said, but he's going to make it off into a separate cell. And I envisioned that his node would just sit there and monitor the APRS track messages whenever, you know, filter only messages, so he's only getting messages, and then he would store these messages, you know, just one line of text, one line of text. He says, no, he's going to convert it to voice. He's going to codec it at one place, save it as voice. I said, you'll be saving megabytes of audio.
Megabytes.
I said, that's the most. He says, Bob, that's a, he's got terabytes. And so he says, you know, get out of the box. He said, let me do that part. And then I finally realized what he was saying, though, and that is the text-to-voice synthesis is not something, I mean, they're almost all licensable or something, and they're not things that, he said, trying to replicate that into every single node. He didn't like that. So he texts to voice.
In one place.
But now he says the advantage of it is now it doesn't have to be an all-star. Now, from Echolink or D-Star or anywhere, you could say, what are my APRS messages? And it speaks them back to you.
Hmm.
And I began to realize he's right, because now his engine will just watch all traffic.
Right.
And now not every single instance of A-Star, Echolink, RLP has to be watching APRS. This one side is doing it, and they go there then to get the text. I call it, this is voicemail, because, and of course everything in APRS is supposed to be real time, so this is one step away from that. But, you know, it's a capability, why not? You know, if you know if somebody's sending you an APRS message and you can't get it right now, you could check in with DTMF and get it spoken to you.
Makes sense.
Well, so that's what he's often doing.
Don't we need redundancy in case there's some kind of outage to keep
I think he recognized that. I think he has a redundancy system somehow.
It's hard. I mean, APRS ILS itself has got some pretty good redundancy built in with the rotate DNS servers and stuff like that. But for like, for example, for an email gateway, if you've got multiple email gateways all sitting out there monitoring the full stream, and someone sends a message in saying, send this to email,
you get multiple copies.
Six of these guys get it, they all multiple copy it to you.
This was his other argument about the center one. He says, you only want to have one place that knows whether the message has been read or not.
Yeah.
Because otherwise, you know, it's distributed to all these others and it's sitting there waiting for you. And you, every time you check in another one, you get
You check into this node and it says, hey, you got a message.
Well,
you check.
Unless all those nodes are sharing, are doing a distributed database so that you check in at one, you've checked in at all.
So anyhow, he convinced me to put it in one spot.
You put it in one spot. He's right. But again, the problem is getting hams to coordinate stuff like that is like herding cats.
Oh gosh.
Because people get very territorial, and you know, if I'm gonna donate this server, then I need to be in charge of it. And you know.
Yeah.
I understand that. I have a problem with if I wrote this source code, then nobody else should be able to use it. I mean, and that's something that I've, all of my source code is up on SourceForge. It's all kept, and matter of fact, APRS Droid, if you look in the credits, George has got me listed there because he's using my codecs that I wrote for this stuff in APRS Droid. He's like, hey man, you wrote these, they're open source, I'm gonna use them too. So,
well, now codec, that means voice to.
Well, no, when I say codec, the decoders for, the parsers, parsers for the messages, which is, you only get 150 some odd characters. It's amazing how many bit combinations you can have in 100.
Okay, so your implementation of APRS so far is the query, and then I want to talk, and it tells you the echo link, and that's
correct.
Okay, and so, but you haven't done then the because
the other guy act.
Because you are APRS users at both ends. Yeah, it's an APRS system. Got it.
Yeah,
and that's why the DTMF does not involve you at this point.
Correct.
Got it.
Correct. And the thing about DTMF is that has to be distributed. Right, that has to be at the local at the local site, and you either have you're having repeater owners making hardware modifications to their system, or and this is actually very clever. The Echolink R and L's, right? The remotes. That's very clever. That you can if you want to be high speed and embed this right into your repeater, that's great. However, you can also run it as a local node that's just on your local repeater frequency.
Right.
So that's the same thing with the DTMF. Now we come up with just a box that you just plug in that's got, you know, audio in on one side from your radio and Ethernet on the other side, and now all of a sudden, boom, it's I have that box, by the way.
But you're still going out and adding that piece of hardware to all of
it. Yeah, but you can add that piece of hardware. I don't have to make a trip to the top of the mountain and convince the Radio Shack owner that I need another power port and then find a way to jack it into my repeater and then get IP off the top of the mountain, which is a lot harder than most, because most repeaters don't have IP running to them.
So how is it implemented?
You just implement it as you plug in anybody that's monitoring a repeater constantly plugs it in, although you really want to listen on the repeater input frequency.
Yeah.
Because most repeaters will mask your tones, which makes it a little trickier.
Well, my the APRS TT, one year I got super excited at Dayton when I realized, sure, all I got to talk is the five different people that make repeater controllers, because they're sitting there listening to DTMF on the input, and I'll do that. So I talked to a couple of them, and one or two of them got very interested, but then, when they got to thinking about it, and then all these DTMF codes are going to be coming in on the input of their controller, the chance of screwing up the settings of the repeater, because they didn't have standard codes. Operator was able to define whatever codes he wanted to do whatever he wanted to with his repeater. So he says, I have no way of telling you, Bob, what characters to avoid, because I don't know what everybody. So that's when I realized that'll never happen. Because repeater owners are going to not want to have people just throwing DTMF tones on the input of their repeater.
So, but it'll still work well on a simplex for a local area and a simplex, a simplex type net.
And I've already chosen the frequency. Simplex. It's 146.58, and the reason is because 5.8 works. There was a reason, but I think it was because in those states that have 20 kilohertz channel spacing and those that have 15 kilohertz channel spacings, 146.58 is
split on both.
Yes.
That makes sense.
And it doesn't have to be a repeater. It's purely simplex because it's listening to DTMF and it's speaking APRS back. So now you don't have to have cavities. You just put them anywhere. It's like cell phone towers.
Who's going to put them there, though, is the question.
That's
people that need them.
People that want them.
Yeah. Or you just you put it out as software that can be run on anything, really. You just say, hey, here's a software package that does this. You can put it on your old 386 computer as long as it has a sound card.
Oh, I should have mentioned. TinyTrack, Bionics has already done it. He has an APRS TT, which is a DTMF decoder, motherboard that plugs into his TT4, TinyTracker 4, and so it receives the DTMF and it sends out the packet. But what he hasn't done is the reverse, and that is speaking back to the user. Well, for APRS TT to be any value, the guy's got to get information back. But at least he did that input half, so that, again, this idea of sending your DTMF call sign and you have presence now in the APRS system.
Let me interrupt you real briefly.
Yeah.
We just kept the tape rolling while you guys were talking. Is it okay to tack that onto the tail end of the...
I don't have a problem with that.
Oh, boy, so my rear end's going to be famous.
Well, at least you got my good side.
You are
an 8000,
John. 8000, okay.
Yeah. And I'll be speaking tomorrow with Bob. We need to. We're getting booted. Is that correct?
I would never boot you.
The big burly man. The big burly man
outside. I'd like to set you up for dinner.
Yeah, you may have that.